program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
San Diego Sheriff's Office calling all cars. Attention all Los Angeles County Sheriff's cars. Broadcast 164. Be on the lookout for a tan sedan driven by one or two men. Has Laguna Beach Cab Company lettered on side of car. It's thought to be used in hold up and shooting in Laguna Canyon. These men are armed and dangerous. That's all.
Larger and larger goes the roll call of cities and counties using Rio Grande Tracks gasoline exclusively. At this time, we proudly salute three new cities: Pasadena, the station center of culture and wealth; Phoenix, capital and metropolis of the great state of Arizona; Marysville, of the fabulous, famous Mother Lode country. Veteran Pasadena officers have frequently proved they could speed it out and win. Phoenix is rooted in desert tradition. No city in the West has a more colorful or more heroic background than Marysville. To serve the law in these places, men must be courageous, hard-hitting, hard-driving men of action, and so they are. And so they chose Rio Grande Tracks gasoline, already able to both service for Oakland, Berkeley, Fresno, Santa Barbara, Los Angeles, San Diego, Orange County, San Diego County, Maricopa County, Arizona, and many, many other cities and counties. In fact, last year, 3,724,318 gallons of Rio Grande Tracks gasoline were used by law enforcement officers. This is enough gasoline to drive 10,000 cars to the Atlantic seaboard, in fact. Do you know of any other gasoline that can point to such overwhelming preference? Try Rio Grande Tracks gasoline in your car. See your independent Rio Grande dealer tomorrow. Tonight, we take pleasure in presenting Deputy Sheriff Jim Workman of the Santa Ana Sheriff's Office. Deputy Workman.
Good evening. Tonight's Calling All Cars is an excellent example of the futility of crime used as a means of getting some easy money. The boys implicated in this case were both under 20 years of age. They had no real reason for turning to a criminal career other than that of being too lazy to take on the responsibilities of an honest job. Theirs was no kind of passion. No sudden, uncontrollable emotion made them lose their head. It was an act of sheer brutality, of almost unbelievable cruelty. Our office, in cooperation with the authorities of Laguna Beach, Huntington Beach, and others up and down the coast, made every effort to apprehend these youths as soon as the report came in. And we did. One within 24 hours of the crime, and the other a few days later. How this was done will be related now in the following dramatization.
It is early evening, June 16th, in a little village known as Laguna Beach. Nestled snugly between the rolling foothills and the Pacific Ocean, this colony for years has been the home of many of California's most brilliant thinkers. Here, too, the little theater buzzes with furious activity the year round, an outlet for the artistic temperament of Laguna's populace. Seated behind the driver's wheel of his parked taxi, Harold Marshall, 26-year-old cab driver, waits on call, chats at intervals with friends as they pass his stand.
Hi, Harold. Keeping you busy tonight?
Not too busy, Harold. Just coming to work?
Yeah, I draw the night shift.
Ought to be a mob in later. There's a party for the cast of that play they put on last night up in Silverado Canyon somewhere. I guess everyone will be out there.
Good enough. I guess I better keep the old coffee pot full just in case. Did you see the play?
No, I didn't get a chance. Heard it was pretty swell, though.
I didn't either. Working as usual. Well, don't take any wooden nickels. I got to get inside and start picking up the short orders. See you later.
Okay, Harris. I'll be in for some of that coffee later myself. Okay, thanks.
formality of Laguna, where everyone knows everyone else by his first name, where such things as street numbers are unheard of. Out the coast highway a quarter of a mile, young Marshall pulls his cab to a stop in front of a brown, board and bat studio house, over whose portals hangs a large sign reading Mona's Studio Club, Laguna's only nightclub. Shutting off the motor, he walks to the door, opens it, steps inside.
Downtown?
Sure will, Mona. Hello, Johnny.
Bud, hi.
Couldn't be better. Place looks kind of deserted tonight.
It's that party up the canyon. This town isn't big enough for two parties the same night.
Oh, don't worry. They'll all be in here later.
Oh, I'm not worrying. Not this one.
Your mother ready, Mona?
In a minute, Bud.
Okay, I'll be outside.
All right. I'll send
you out. Hey, Bud. This is the fellow I was looking for. How do you get the Silverado Canyon Drive from here?
You going to the party too, Dean?
Yeah, I wouldn't miss it. Let's see if I can find the place.
Well, you know where the Dude Ranch is, out the canyon?
Yeah.
Well, just past there, there's a little road turns up to the right. Not much more than a cow path. Room enough for about 1.5 cars at a time.
Sounds swell.
You can make it all right, though. Once you get on the road, just follow your nose and suddenly you're there. Now, I gotta go now. Here's Mona's mother.
Okay, Bud. Thanks a million.
Maybe I'll see you up there later.
Yeah, okay. I'll see you later.
And a few minutes later, Harold Marshall dropped his fare to the destination, then returned to his stand in front of the sandwich mill. As he's about to turn off the motor, two men approach the cab. Not recognizing either of them, he decides they must be out of towners looking for a ride. After a moment's hesitation, one of them speaks.
Good chap for hire?
Sure is.
Okay. Want to go for a ride?
All right. Hop in.
Now, where to?
Well, I'll just drive out the canyon away. I'm not just sure of the address.
You going to the cast party?
No. No, we're just going out the canyon away. We'll tell you where to stop.
Okay.
Don't ask questions. Can't stand here all night gabbing. What'll we do? Leave him here?
Hey, look. There's a cut on the roof. I see it. We better beat it.
Oh, no, quick. Take this guy's hat and pull it down over your head. Now get in the seat there and look as though you're waiting for somebody.
What are you going to do?
Just lie down here and keep this guy from squawking. Get in the cab.
Okay.
What's all excitement, Harris?
Bud Marshall got held up in Cotton.
What? Hey, that's terrible. Where is he?
They took him to Santa Ana. Got to operate on him.
Gee. Did they get the guy that did it?
Uh-uh. There was two of them. Took Bud's cab to escape him.
Well, say, if that doesn't... Huh? They took Bud's cab?
Yeah.
Benny. Hey, Benny. Did you hear that? They took Bud's cab.
Well, what's so amazing about that?
Gosh, I saw him.
You what?
I saw him. Talk to him. I suppose you could have touched him.
What are you talking about?
Hey, Jack.
Yeah?
Hey, listen. About 15 minutes ago, I was up at Silverado Canyon trying to find a party, and I saw Bud's cab driving around.
You sure it was his cab?
Sure, I'm sure. And there were two fellas in it. I asked them where Silverado Place was, and one of them said he didn't know, and they drove off.
Yeah, that was only 15 minutes ago.
Yeah?
Yeah, Allison. Yeah? Tell the boys we're going up the canyon. I've got a lead as to where those guys are.
And a few minutes later, a hastily organized posse of police, deputy sheriffs, and citizens start a manhunt that covers every inch of the canyon territory. All night, the search continues through thick mountain brush. But as the first rays of the morning sun announce the new day, the weary members of the posse admit defeat and return to their homes. It is apparent to all that the vicious gunmen have made good their escape. And at the St. Joseph's Hospital in Santa Ana, young Harold Marshall spends the long hours of the night in the operating room while surgeons make a supreme effort to sustain the small flicker of life that minute by minute grows weaker. Then, late the following afternoon, in the service station of Huntington Beach, 15 miles north of Laguna.
Yes. Hello, young fellow. Something I can do for you?
I just thought I'd get a drink of water if it's all right. It's kind of hot walking.
Sure thing. Help yourself.
Thanks.
I wish you could bring a little business with you. I don't think there's been 10 cars in here since I opened up this morning. They'd make a million that way.
Yeah. Yeah, I guess you're right.
And I'll bet that out of those 10 cars, at least 5 of them wanted water, tires checked, and directions as how to get somewhere, and nothing else.
From Laguna?
Laguna?
Yeah, down the highway there.
Oh, I know where it is. He used to live there. Don't remember any Laguna ticks coming in today, though.
I thought maybe you'd heard how that fellow that got shot down there last night was getting along.
Oh, you mean Bud Marshall?
Yeah, I guess so. Cab driver?
Yeah. I read about it in the paper this morning. He'd be tough on him.
Yeah, he's still alive, isn't he?
Yeah. Was when I read about it. Paper said he was off for a load.
Gosh.
What's the matter? You know him, huh?
No, I don't know him. I just
thought maybe he was a close friend of yours, the way you sounded.
No, I never heard of him before. I was just thinking, well, guess I'll blow. Thanks a lot. Well,
he's yours. It's all right. I've heard a lot of silly questions that this kid takes the truth. They've gotten to hurry to go all of a sudden. Think someone was after me. Hey, wait a minute. There was a couple of kids that did that job in Laguna. Hello, operator. Get me the police station, quick. Yeah, and make it fast, will you?
Listen, I tell you, I don't know anything about it.
What was the idea of asking all those questions?
Well, I was only wondering how the fellow was, that's all.
Well, where'd you hear about the shooting?
I read it in the paper.
Which paper?
The Times.
Sure it wasn't the Examiner?
No, I'm not sure, no, but
I'm... Well, in fact, it wasn't even in the Times, was it?
Well, I guess maybe it was the Examiner.
I guess maybe we'd better take a ride to Santa Ana and see what else you know. I have an idea that's plenty.
Driven to the sheriff's office in Santa Ana, the young inquirer continues to deny everything. And after an hour of grilling, deputy is taken to St. Joseph's Hospital into the small, darkened room where Harold Marshall lies hovering between life and death. Turn a light on his face.
All right, sir. If you can wake him, we're ready.
Harold. Harold. I may not be able to. Very weak.
Thank you, dear.
Harold. Harold Marshall. Can you hear me, Harold?
Uh-huh.
Do you think you could open your eyes for a minute?
Harold.
Can you see me over here?
That's one of the tallest. That's the one.
That's all there. Thanks. Come on, you. Well, what do you say now, young fella? Come on, let's not see each other anymore. No go. Well, how about it then? Can you tell us all about it? Okay, kid. We'll go back to the station. And when we get there, you'll tell?
Yes.
And a little later, the now thoroughly scared young man makes a complete confession. Gives his name as Fulton DeMord. Names his companion as one Gerald Vance. But when asked where his crime mate is, he claims he has no idea. Swears that he hasn't seen him since they separated the night of the shooting. And despite continued grilling, he sticks to his story. Finally convinces the sheriff of the truth. Then, just as the questioning is ending, DeMord unwittingly gives a hot lead.
That's all I can tell you, sir. I didn't even know Jerry well. I ran into him in town one night, and we went out to his place.
His home?
Yeah.
Where is it?
In Chino.
Yeah, well. Come on, boys. We're taking a ride to Chino, and DeMord here is going to show us where Vance lives.
Hey, wait a minute. I didn't run. I don't want to
save
do that.
Save it. What you want to do is your business. But what you're going to do is a very different thing. Come on.
Leading to Chino, the officers locate Vance's home, but fail to find him. They do, however, get a full description, as well as a recent snapshot. And armed with these, a statewide bulletin sliced to all points. Teletype messages feed over the huge police network.
Attention all points. Bulletin. One for kidnapping, assault with a deadly weapon. Gerald Vance, 18 years, dark hair, medium build, last seen Laguna Beach, California, June 16th this year. This man is known to have a gun. Might resist arrest. If located, arrest and notify Sheriff Orange County.
1 week later in Medford, Oregon, on one of the numerous ranches.
Hey, come on, son.
Okay, I guess.
It's a good job for you, young fella.
Yeah.
Yeah, looks kind of hot, though.
Yeah. That's so funny, me looking hot. I suppose maybe I should wear an overcoat while I chop this wood. The sun trying to set a new record for being hot.
Ah, take it easy, son. Didn't get sore just because I rib you a little. I don't mean nothing by it.
Well, we'll save it then. This isn't my idea of having a good time, just chopping wood. You don't help it any by standing around jabbing.
By golly, for a little fella, you're the toughest kid I ever seen. You can't say boo without just going all up in the ladder. But there's something on your mind, eh?
No, I haven't anything on my mind.
Still at all, huh? Well, guess I might as well leave you be as long as you're this way. No use trying to be... Hey, now who in the blazes can that be tramping around over there? Never saw him before.
Where?
Over by the house. Coming this way now. Looks like an officer or something.
Give me the cop.
Yeah, looks like it. Soon know, though, he's coming over here. Hey, what's the matter with you? Looks like you'd see the ghost.
It's nothing, nothing. Just a heat stick. Why don't you go and see what he wants?
Well, there ain't no use my going over to him when he's coming over to me.
Yeah, but...
Besides, I don't feel much like walking.
Hello there. You the foreman of this ranch?
Well, foreman's away, so I guess I'm next best. What can I do for you?
I'm looking for a young fellow who might be working around these parts. He's about 18 years old. You seen anyone like that?
Sure. Got one right here.
Oh, no, you don't. Let me go. I ain't gonna...
What's the hurry, then?
That's my business.
Sure. Only I wouldn't try running out again if you know what's good for you.
Yeah, what the devil is all this about, anyway?
Here's a picture, Pop. Ever seen this kid before?
Say, here's a picture of you, kid.
That's what I thought. Now listen, Vance. I'm not gonna waste any time fooling with you. You're coming along with me nice and peacefully... And there's going to be no arguments, am I right?
Yeah, what do you think?
I think you're a pretty fresh punk. And I think I know how to handle punks. How's that? Can't think of an answer, is that right? Well, that suits me fine. The less you talk on the way back to town, the more I'll like it. Come on, get moving.
Notified by teletype of the arrest, Orange County officers speed to Medford, bring the suspect back to Santa Ana. And there they hurl question after question at him, receiving as replies a stony silence. So once again, young Marshall is waked out of his coma, and once again he looks for an instant at the face framed in brilliant light, then names the boy as the other gunman, names him as the one who actually shot him. And a little later, with his positive identification completed, Vance and DeMord are brought together for the first time since the shooting. Stand side by side as the sheriff talks to them.
Well, boys, the game's up. You're right on a well-known spot, and you know it, don't you?
Yes.
You're pretty young to start living in San Quentin.
San Quentin?
Sure, that's where they send people to do what you did.
But they can't send us up there. They can't do it.
Sorry, young fella. You're the one who made it this way, you know. Maybe if you'd have thought a little more before you pulled this job, things would be different. But you shot a man and thought you'd get out of it scot-free. But now you know different. If you're lucky in one way, though. There's a pretty good chance that your victim will pull through. But if he does, at least you won't have murder on your hands.
What? What's he bump?
And it's going to be just too bad for both of you.
What?
Even if he doesn't bump, as you put it, the doctor says he'll never walk again. Those slugs you pumped into him have severed his spine.
God.
Not a very pretty thought to have to live with, is it, boys?
I didn't think about that when I did it.
Why'd you do it, Jim?
It all looked so simple then, and now I can't do it. I don't want to go to jail. Please, Sheriff, if I promise it was straight, if I promise on my word of honor, anything...
Sorry, Jerry, it's too late for that now. You might just as well make up your mind to take a joke, because there's no way out. That's the law.
And after a preliminary hearing held in St. Joseph's Hospital at the wounded boy's bedside, a short trial finishes the criminal career of Gerald Vance and Fulton DeBoard when they are sentenced to serve life imprisonment in San Quentin Penitentiary without possibility of parole. Their victim, Harold Marshall, recovered from his experience, but today is still suffering complete paralysis of both legs.
Thank you, Deputy Wilson. Nearly 3¾ million gallons of Rio Grande cracked gasoline used last year in protecting life and property in this territory. No other gasoline can point to such dramatic surge. If your car could have been started when Christianity was born, and driven normally every day until now, scarcely more than a third of this huge quantity of gasoline would have been consumed. More police cars, fire engines, ambulances, and other emergency equipment use Rio Grande cracked gasoline wherever it is sold than any other brand. Why don't you try it in your car? Just drive in tomorrow to your nearest independent Rio Grande dealer. He can also offer you the finest motor oils you can buy, Sinclair Pennsylvania and Sinclair Opaline. Both are thoroughly blue-waxed, seed-jellied, and refinery-sealed in tamper-proof cans. They are so free-flowing in winter, and they stand up so completely under the most terrific engine heat that you can use the same grade the year-round. Ask your Rio Grande dealer about Sinclair Motor Oils tomorrow. Ask him, too, for a free copy of Calling All Cars News, full of pictures and stories about your favorite radio and screen stars and many special features. Do this tomorrow. This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company.